So we're going to go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer, and we're going to start our Sunday service. Father, we thank you so much for this day, the beautiful sunshine outside, and just our ability to be here this morning, to sit under the teaching of your word, to stand with other believers and lift our voices up to your throne. Father God, we thank you for that. Father, I thank you that there were hundreds of other places that we could have been this morning, but we chose to be in your house. So I thank you for that, Father God, the privilege and the honor it is to be here and to serve you, Father God. I pray that you would just come, send your Holy Spirit this morning, Father God. I pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, your word would be alive in us today, Father God, that you would illuminate your word to us, Father God. Give us an understanding that we've never had before, Father. Father, we thank you for everyone that is here this morning. We ask a special blessing on each one of them, Father God. And I want to pray for those who are not with us this morning, Father God. Bring them back. Father, bring them back into fellowship with us, Father. We just want to thank you for that, that we have the ability, Father, to be your hands and feet. So help us, Father, as we go throughout our week to show the love of Jesus to those who you have put in our path. Father, we thank you that you love us. We thank you that you sent your Son to die for us, Father God. And we, this morning, want to come and give our lives back to you. So, Father, we ask that you would just bless us in our efforts here this morning, Father God. As feeble as our attempts may be in our flesh, Father God, to honor you the way that you should be honored, we just ask for your special blessing upon this service. And it's in the strong name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning, guys. I just want to give a quick testimony. All you guys know, you know, going through cancer treatment and all that kind of stuff. I really, really appreciate your prayers. I could feel them. And one of the things I was going through while I was going through the cancer treatment, I felt like the Lord told me to sit, write it down. So I started carrying a notebook with me. And he started giving me songs. And you people don't, you guys don't know me all that well. It's, you know, we've only been coming here for a while. But, man, poetry and putting words and stuff like that together is not my forte, you know, so, you know, I have a hard time putting a couple of sentences together, let alone, you know, making something sound pretty. Anyway, the Lord started giving me these, you know, parts of songs or just verses or whatever, and I started writing it down, and they have come together to become something, and I didn't get any of the music for it, I just got the lyrics, and I sent it to Cody. And, man, the Lord's been working on him, too. And some of the stuff that he's been coming up with to put it together is just amazing. I just ask if you guys would continue to pray for me and for us so that, you know, wherever the Lord wants us to go, whatever he wants us to do with it, that it's his will and that we don't get in the way. And so this first song that we do today is one of the ones that the Lord gave us.
Amen.
Shame, it's coming down. All your pain,
my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I fall on you. Oh, 'cause Jesus, you're my hope and to leave the God I love.
be seated, church. And if you would, let's bow our heads as we go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful, God, to be here this morning. God, to be amongst brothers and sisters in Christ, Lord. Father, the body of Christ, Lord. And thank you, God, for your presence here with us this morning. Lord, we just want to pray, Lord, and thank you, God, for your continued, consistent provision, Lord, for our every need and your faithfulness in all things, Lord. And Father, I pray that today as we come, we give our tithe and offering, Lord, that God, that you would just bless it, multiply, God, and use it, God, for your glory, your purpose, your kingdom, Lord. We pray for direction and wisdom for the leadership here, Lord, that we would, God, just follow your leading, Lord, in all things, Lord. Father, we pray, God, that you would bless the teaching of your word now, Lord, and ask, God, that, Lord, that you would just open our hearts and minds to you, Father. Help us to understand, Father God, and then to receive and to apply, Lord. We know that your word is more than for knowledge, Lord. It is for the life of the believer, Lord, to walk in obedience and faithfulness, Lord. And I pray, Father God, that you would just open our hearts to you this morning. I pray, Lord, that you set me aside, use me as your vessel, Lord, to bring your word, God, to your people. We pray, Lord, all of this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
All right, we can go ahead and dismiss our children next door for Children's Church. Dave. While they're doing that, if you would turn in your Bibles to Joshua chapter 23. Okay, we're actually going to be wrapping up our study, our look at the book of Joshua this morning, looking at chapter 23 and a little bit in chapter 24. How are we this morning, church?
Amazing.
We doing okay? Was it a good week? An oh-so kind of good week? Was it
wonderful week?
All right, every day with the Lord is good, right?
Always.
Amen to that.
Amen.
Give me an amen also if you found the book of Joshua. Are you there?
Amen.
All right, Joshua chapter 23. I'm actually not going to begin there. All right. But Nikki's going to have it up on the screen. We're going to be looking at, first looking at the Gospel of John chapter 17, okay, and then over to the Paul's letter to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 2, 3, and 4. We're going to look at a lot of scripture this morning. You're all okay with that?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So there's going to be a lot of reading. In fact, if you were to look up here today, I don't have a single note, okay? What we're going to do is, through expository preaching, is just break down passage by passage, but just verse by verse, and just really look at what the Word of God is trying to say to God's people today, okay? So looking at
Joshua 23.
Well, I guess let me first kind of explain where we're at in the book of Joshua, okay? We have been traveling for a long time with Israel, right, as they have gone from their slavery in Egypt into the wilderness, right? That first generation that got to the Jordan, that sent spies across to spy out the land of Canaan and its inhabitants. And whenever they came back with a report, you know, 10 out of the 12 said, man, they're, you know, the people over there, they're greater, they're stronger than us. There's no way that we can possess this land, right? And therefore, they would wander in the wilderness for 40 years. But then there would be this next generation, right, that Moses would lead to the promised land, lead to the Jordan, but not have the opportunity to go into the Jordan. Then Joshua would take his place, right, lead the Israelites over the land of the river Jordan into the land of Canaan. And we have looked at several incidences where they have faced their enemies, the people and the inhabitants of Canaan. Their first was Jericho. They experienced a great victory over Jericho, but then they lost to the smaller, less significant city, to the city of Ai, right? They lost to that because of Achan, who took of the detestable things of Jericho, which God had commanded them all, don't take the spoils from Jericho, but take the precious metals and put them in the storehouse of the Lord. We talked about, what got Achan to that point last week, right? We talked about how he had seen, right, the Babylonian garment, the gold and the silver and the bronze. And then he says, I coveted it, and then I took it, right? And that is the progress of sin in our life, right? Seeing it, the temptation's not the sin. But the moment that we covet it in our heart, right? From the moment that we desire it, it becomes sin. And then that conceives us, it conceives within us. And that coveting leads to taking, right? Or to fulfilling that. And that is the progress of sin. Well, now we're going to see that as you, if you were to just go through the whole book of Joshua, you would see how God would just deliver them just one after the other as they would face the inhabitants of Canaan, and they would take the possession of the land that God had given them, that God had promised them. And now they have conquered all these places, they have taken the land, they divided it up amongst the 12 tribes, and each one was given their own lot of land. And now Joshua has given them a command. He's instructing them, as it tells us in chapter 23, that Joshua is now an old man. All right, he's coming to the nearness of the end of his life, and he's wanting to leave Israel in a right place, in a right position, that they might continue to walk in faithfulness to God and continue to experience the blessings of God as they have now taken this new land, and it's become theirs because God had given it to them. What I want to talk to you, and you've probably heard people say it before, you know, that we are to be in the world, right, but not to be of the world, okay? I want us to know what that means, okay? And the Bible addresses that very clearly, okay? And the first thing I want to read to you this morning is found in the book of John, the Gospel of John, in chapter 17, beginning with verse 6. And I'm going to read all the way through verse 20, all right? Like I told you, we're going to cover a lot of ground this morning. In verse 6, and Nick, you'll have it up here on the screen. Jesus is praying here for his disciples, all right, for his 12. But then we're going to see later on in verse 20 that he's not just praying for his disciples, but he's praying for all of those who would come in faith and receive him as their Savior, which would be us, right, those who are in Christ. But in verse 6 it says, I have manifested your name to the men whom you have given me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they have known that all things which you have given me are from you. For I have given to them the words which you have given me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came forth from you. And they have believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. And all of mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. Now I am no longer in the world, but these are in the world. And I come to you, Holy Father, keep through your name those whom you have given me, that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in your name. Those whom you gave me, I have kept the Son of I have kept, and none of them is lost except for the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I come to you, and these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also may be sanctified by the truth. And then in verse 20, he says, I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. So Jesus here is praying to the Father, and he's praying for his disciples. And Jesus is preparing them, as he's been preparing them for his departure, his ascension into heaven, when he would die on the cross, be buried for 3 days, and on the third day rise again. Then he would spend 40 days in their presence, the resurrected body of Christ, teaching them, instructing them, preparing them, right? Then in his ascension, when he would leave them, now the disciples would be on their own, right? Except for the difference is that they would receive the Holy Spirit at the day of Pentecost, right? And then the Spirit of God living in them, equipping them and for every good work, right? And then sending them forth. Jesus was preparing his disciples to go forth, to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ to all the world. And he's praying specifically for them here. And he says, in verse 13, he says, "But now I come to you, and these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world." But then he says, "I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil one." You see, Jesus says, "I'm not praying that you would take them out of the world." Their purpose is to be in the world, to be the light of the world, right? To be salt to the earth, light to the world. To come forth and bring the gospel of Jesus Christ, the power of God to salvation for anyone who would believe. You know, it was these very disciples, it was said of them in the book of Acts, that here these men are, they have come and they're turning the whole world upside down. These same individuals, these same 12 men that were at the garden experience whenever Jesus was in Gethsemane. Right, and the temple guards came to take Jesus, and all of them fled. Now these men were emboldened and empowered to bring forth the gospel of Jesus Christ. They had to be in the world, but he does say, "I don't pray that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one." Now what is Jesus speaking of when he's speaking of the world? Is he speaking about every individual that is part of this world? No, he's speaking specifically of the ideology, the theology that is in the world, right? That is governed by the God of this world, by Satan. And that's why he says, I'm not praying that you take them out of the world, but I'm praying that you would protect them from the evil one. We're here for mission, church. All of God's people are here for mission. We have to be in this world. But church, at the same time, we are to be separate from this world. Right? I mean, the Bible tells us in the book of Romans, the Apostle Paul, Romans chapter 12, says that we are not to be conformed to this world. In other words, we're not to adopt its patterns, right? To accept its ideology. But yet we are to be conformed. I mean, we're being renewed. And we're to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. The renewing of our minds comes from the very thing that Jesus makes mention of here when he asks God the Father to sanctify them by his word. Sanctify, meaning that he would set them apart from the world while they had to be in the world, but he would sanctify them unto himself through his word, and that's why Jesus says, "Thy word is truth." Now, Jesus was speaking of absolute truth, okay? He wasn't just saying that the Word of God is another idea or another opinion or someone's thoughts. He is saying that this is the Word of God and it is the truth and therefore stand on it, right? Because you have to be in this world. You and I have to walk in society and be involved in all that's going around in some sense of that idea. But at the same time, we can't be of it. We have to be sanctified, set apart by what? By God's Word. In other words, church, there's a lot of doctrines, a lot of teachings, a lot of ideas going out on in our society today. And you don't have to look very hard to see some different opinion that is in opposition to God's Word, His truth. It's everywhere. Turn on the TV, you turn on the radio, man, it's everywhere. There is something that is trying to be pushed on every single one of us every day that we're in the world. And the only way that we're going to be able to resist and stand against that is to stand on the truth of God's Word. And Jesus specifically says that your Word is truth. Your Word is truth. Now let's look at that for a moment. Let's turn to the book of 2 Timothy. I want to first talk to you about the responsibility of the minister. Okay? You know, the book of Timothy, right, 1 and 2 Timothy, was Paul's letter to Timothy, who Paul was Timothy's mentor. He was training, he was teaching Timothy to take the position of an elder in the church of Ephesus, and he had placed Timothy for the purpose to minister to God's people, to teach them the word, to instruct them in righteousness and holiness, to guide and direct them, and to be the pastor there at that church. I want to read to you, beginning with verse 14 in chapter 2. This is what the Apostle Paul instructs Timothy on. He says, "Remind them of these things, charging them before the Lord not to strive about words to no profit, to the ruin of the hearers. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." What is that word? Well, he's going to make it clear here in just a moment in chapter 3 what that word is. He says, "But shun profane, idle babblings, for they will increase to more ungodliness, and their message will spread like cancer. Hymenaeus and Philetus are of this sort, who have strayed concerning the truth, saying that the resurrection is already past, and they overthrow the faith of some." You see, Paul was saying, Timothy, right, make sure that you show yourself approved to God by studying the Word of God, by rightly dividing the Word of God, right, by preaching and teaching the Word of God in its fullness, not a bit here and a bit there. We've talked about how important it is not to take just a passage of Scripture and build a whole theology or whole doctrine based on one passage, church. That's how many false religions have been started throughout the ages. We are to be a people of the Word of God, to stand on the truth, to know and recognize that this is the breathed out, inspired Word of God, and that it is true. Church, if we're not grounded on the truth, then all the deception that is around us will eventually enter in. We'll adopt that theology, that ideology, instead of adopting the truth of God's Word. We're called to be a people of the Word of God, to stand on it, to know it, to put it inside of us. I love what the psalmist writes when he says, "I hide thy word in my heart that I might not sin against you." We have to hide it in our heart, to know it. And not only know it, because it's more than just for head knowledge, it's for application, that we are to be doers and not hearers only. To stand on the Word of God, because listen, church, there's so much out there today that if we're not protecting our minds from it, we will be influenced by it. If we're not teaching it to our children will be influenced by it. And we will see a whole generation miss out on what God is trying to do just because we haven't been diligent teaching our children, standing on the Word of God, being an example of faith for them. That listen, whenever the lies come up, we say, "No, I recognize it. I understand it. I know that that is contrary to the Word of God. And I want to stand on the truth of God's Word. And I'm going to let God's Word be the foundation for I stand upon." We're to be a people of the Word. And what is the Word that he is talking about, the Word of truth? Well, in chapter 3, in verses 16 and 17, he tells Timothy all Scripture. What does that mean? All Scripture, right? From cover to cover. All Scripture, he says, is given by inspiration of God. And then he says it's profitable. Profitable for what? He says for doctrine, for teaching, for reproof and correction. And he says an instruction in righteousness. He says that the man of God may be be complete and thoroughly equipped for every good work. He's telling Timothy, listen, if you're going to be a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, you got to show yourself that you're worthy of that by rightly dividing the word of truth, knowing that it's the true word of God. It's breathed out by God. It's His word. It is true. You stand on it. And then in chapter 4, beginning with verse 1, he says, "I charge you." Paul says, Timothy, this is your job. This is your responsibility. He says, "I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ." In other words, he's saying, as God is my witness, this is what my charge is to you. "I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead at His appearing in His kingdom." We know that there's an impending judgment coming on the world, right? He says, "Preach the word." There it is. What was Timothy's responsibility? Preach the word. didn't say, hey, you just preach what you feel, or you know, you depend on your emotions or your feelings, or you teach your opinion or your thoughts or your interpretation of the scripture. No, he said, preach the word. He says, be ready in season and out. Convince, he says, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and teaching. For the time will come, he says, when they will not adhere to sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers. Can I tell you that has plagued the church today? Amen. You know, the thing about working through God's Word and through expository teaching and preaching, it forces you not to skip over things. This isn't always easy for us to hear, but that doesn't make it any less important for us to apply into our lives. God's Word is truth. And Paul says it's profitable. It's profitable for teaching. It's profitable for rebuke. And rebuke is not always easy, is it? It's not always pleasant. But sometimes God's words bring about conviction on our hearts in its purpose to correct us and to instruct us in righteousness. Paul says, preach it, Timothy. Preach God's Word. There's coming a day. And can I tell you, it was happening back then and it's happening today, when there will be those who do not want to adhere to sound doctrine, in other words, right teaching, sound teaching, but instead they will heap up for themselves teachers just because they have itching ears. Now, speaking of people who just want to hear what they want to hear. They want to take the goodness, the love, the mercy of God, but they don't want to look at the full counsel of God and understand His full character and nature and know that everything, every aspect, every characteristic of God is based on His love, including His correction, including that He is a just and holy God. He says, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. But you be watchful in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. In other words, Paul is saying, at all cost, Timothy, at all cost. And can I tell you, by experience, over the past 10 years now in ministry, it cost. It cost the preacher. But the benefit is far greater than the cost, because I know that if the Word of God is being preached, it will not return to Him void. Amen. And can I tell you that I understand, I know my responsibility, because the Word of God instructs me on what my responsibility is. And I know what the book of John tells us, and James tells us, that let not many of you become teachers, because we will be held to a higher accountability. I want to ask you this morning, do you know your responsibility in all of this? Because listen, my part is to tell you the truth, to bring forth the Word of God and to present it to you. But it's your part to take it and to apply it to your lives. See, I'm not responsible for that. I'm responsible for the delivering of it. You're responsible with what you do with it. It's like the prophet Ezekiel says when he's speaking of himself and he's talking about the watchman on the wall. And he says the watchman on the wall's responsibility was to stand on the wall and to watch for the approaching enemy. And if he did not warn the people whenever the enemy came and approached, that the blood of the people would be on him, on the watchman's hands. But he said, but if the watchman sees the enemy coming and he warns the people and they don't hear or they don't adhere to what he's saying, that the blood of the people is on the blood of the people. The Apostle Paul, leaving Ephesus in the book of Acts, says, he told the elders, I'm leaving you. And he says, I'm not accountable for what happens at this point. He says, the blood is not on my hands because I did not withhold from you the whole counsel of God. We have to be in this world, church, but we are not to be of this world. we're not to adopt this theology, it's ideology, church. There's so many denominations and churches that just fall to the wayside because they just cannot stand up to the pressure of the things that are being forced upon them. But I know my responsibility. And I'm here to tell you today that I will die on this hill. I will. Because I'm not called for any other purpose but to bring the Word of God, to preach it. That's my responsibility. Now, what does that have to do with Israel's experience here in Joshua chapter 23? See, I haven't even got started this morning, church. Here in Joshua chapter 23, Joshua is preparing Israel. They had taken possession of the land, but there were still inhabitants of Canaan amongst them. And he tells them here in verse 5, and this is Joshua speaking on behalf of God. He says, "See, I have divided to you by lot these nations that remain to be an inheritance for your tribes from the Jordan with all the nations that, that I have cut off as far as the great sea westward. And the Lord your God will expel them from before you and drive them out of your sight. So you shall possess their land as the Lord your God promised you." Let me take a drink. Mouth getting very dry. Verse 6 says, "Therefore, be what? Very courageous." To do what? To keep and do all that is written in the book of the law of Moses. He says, "Lest you turn aside from it to the right hand or to the left. And lest you go among these nations, these who remain among you, you shall not make mention of the name of their gods or cause anyone to swear by them. You shall not serve them nor bow down to them, but you shall hold fast to the Lord your God as you have done to this day." You see what Jesus was speaking of? You see what is happening here with Israel and with Joshua? He's saying, don't adopt their gods. Don't fall into their ideologies, their patterns. But instead, stay true to the Word of God, right? The Word that was brought forth by Moses. And he says here in verse 8, "But you shall hold fast to the Lord your God as you have done to this day." What got them into the promised land? What gave them the promised land? How were they able to conquer and overcome all these adversaries? God, right? I mean, apart from God, none of that would have been possible. And you know how they were able to accomplish that? By clinging to God. By trusting Him, by obeying Him. That's why they fell with Ai. Because they fell into rebellion and disobedience to God. But He is saying, if you want to continue this, you got to continue doing what you've been doing. And you have to cling and hold fast to the Lord your God. And church, that's what is required of us. Is to hold fast to God, to trust Him in all things, to look to Him for our guidance, our direction, to be firmly planted right in His truth, that we stand on the foundation of His Word, and that we be a people of God. Because apart from Him, we can do nothing. And church, that takes us holding fast to Him, clinging to Him, because there's going to be lots of pressure applied to you if you're trying to walk out this walk of faith as the Apostle Paul is trying to teach Timothy to stay true to. That we would not adhere to, you know, to false teaching or be led astray, led to the left or the right, but that we would know the truth, we would stand on the truth, and we would cling and hold fast to God. He says, "For the Lord has driven out from before you great and strong nations, but as for you, no one has been able to stand against you to this day. One man of you shall chase 1,000, for the Lord your God is he who fights for you, as he promised you. He says, therefore, take heed to yourselves that you love the Lord your God. Can I tell you, church, that one man can't drive out 10,000? He can't. But one man with God can.
Amen.
One individual with God can do great things. But apart from him, we cannot. Apart from him, we cannot do anything of value and worth. And he says, therefore, take careful heed to yourselves that you love the Lord your God. You know, I guarantee you that most people that you walk into any church, you can say, do you love God? Oh yeah, I love God. I love God. But if you start examining the fruit of people, you would realize that that love is shallow. The Bible teaches us, Jesus says, that if you love me, you will keep my commands. You will obey me. You see, what Jesus, what the Lord was saying to Israel here, is he's saying, if you follow me, if you obey me, if you draw near, if you cling to me, then all this that you've been experiencing, it will continue in your progress. It will continue in your life because I'll be with you. But apart from me, you can do nothing. The Bible tells us in 1 John chapter 1 that we're to walk in the light as he is in the light. John speaking to, says that, listen, that his desire was that they might have fellowship with them just as they have fellowship with God. I mean, he was speaking of that intimacy with the Lord. And he says, if any man sins, right, we have an advocate with the Father, Christ Jesus. I'm not saying that we're perfect, church. That is not what I'm preaching here tonight. I mean, this morning. What I'm saying is that we have to be a people that are firmly planted on God's Word, knowing that this is the inspired Word of God. We have to stand on it, and anything that is contrary to it, anything that contradicts it, church, we reject it. Because there's a lie and there's a truth. Truth is not relevant, regardless of what society wants to try to convince you. There's either a truth or there's a lie. We have to choose today. And I want us to turn one more time to chapter 24. And Joshua now confronts all the congregation of Israel. He has just been speaking to the elders. Now he's speaking to the whole congregation of Israel. And he says in verse 14, he says, now therefore, fear the Lord. What does it mean to fear the Lord? This means to have reverence for God. He's not talking about a dreadful fear. He's talking about a reverential fear, right? To know and understand who God is, and to have Him in His rightful place in your life. And church, can I tell you, there's not a lot of fear of God today in our churches. He says, fear the Lord, serve Him, and what? In sincerity and in truth. Put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the river and in Egypt. Serve the Lord. In verse 15 he says, and if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. Whether the gods which your father served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Amen.
You see, Joshua just drew a line in the sand, didn't he?
Yes, he did.
He says, you either serve those false gods or you serve the living God. But you choose today. You choose today. Church, we can't live straddling the fence with one leg in the world and the other in Christ or in the right place with the Lord. We can't. It's just as Jesus says about what it is to serve two masters. He says you can't do it. You'll either love the one or you'll despise the other, but you can't serve both God and man. You can't. It's impossible. But yet I see many a people fall into the wayside because pressure is applied, because they're trying to live with one foot in and one foot out, and you cannot do it. You can't falter between two opinions, as Elijah said. And no, just like Joshua says here, Elijah says, choose. God, Joshua is saying, choose. And that is the call today, Lord, church, is that we choose today. We choose today. Who is it we're going to serve? Either the world, or we serve God. The Bible tells us in James that, listen, that the world is enmity with God. Do you want to be on that side? It's a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. I don't want to be on that side. No. I want to choose such as Joshua has chosen. And he says, as for me. See, I can't say that for you. But I can say that for me. As for me, in my house, we will serve the Lord. Amen. Would you please stand this morning? Church, the line has been drawn. Decision is to be made. If you feel like you've been faltering between two opinions, and you don't know what to believe and what not to believe, choose today, because you can't live in both worlds. You can't. The Bible says that any man that be in Christ is a new creature. The old is passed away. Behold, all things are new. You are a new creature in Christ Jesus. Church, we have to die. Part of that coming to Christ is us dying to ourselves. But if you're still trying to cling and hold on to that and think that you're walking with the Lord, you're not. Because light and darkness don't mix. You can't walk in the light as He is in the light if you continue to cling to darkness in your life. He has come to set you free from that. God's purpose for Israel was not just to deliver them out of Egypt, but to deliver Egypt out of them. That He would make them His own people. The Bible tells us that anyone that is in Christ, we are a new creature in Christ. We are His own special people, Peter says. You're a holy nation, a royal priesthood, His own chosen people. That's who you are. That's your identity. Walk as if you know that and you believe that. Let go of all of the things that are trying to pull you further and further away from the Lord. And say, no, I don't want nothing to do with it. Because I know that my rightful place is right in the presence of the Lord. To know Him, to serve Him, to fear Him, and to walk faithfully with Him. And when you do, when you plant your feet firmly on that truth, that belief, and that understanding, all the things that are coming down to knock down your belief system, trying to tear it apart, will have no success because you have firmly planted your feet upon the truth of God's Word. I can tell you, again, church, listen, there's so much out there right now. It's been, to me, it seems like more prevalent than ever before. That it's just trying to tear everyone up and down and just trying to tear down the foundational truth of God's Word and His principle. But let that not be said of us. And let's make the choice today to step over that line, the same line that Joshua stepped over. And let's say today, and as for me, and as for my house, we will serve the Lord. Invitations open this morning. As they play through this song, if you feel led to come forward, if God's spoken to you, ministered to you in any way, don't walk out these doors not having responded to Him. Let it be known. If you need prayer, I'll be over here to the side.
Thank you.
come now, fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of bounties praise. Teach me some melodious song, sung by flaming tongues above. Raise a mountain fixed upon a mountain I return to.
How about a 1, 2, 3 hallelujah this morning as we dismiss? 1, 2, 3.
Hallelujah.